Okay.
You take this. And
so this is the process for how you make the controller for the compressed earth brick press, the driver for the solenoids. So what do we got?
So you take this copper clad board and remove from its packaging, and when you're removing this copper board, be careful not to touch its copper surface with your hands because it's got oils and that.
Hey, can you take off your hood? I can't see your face.
That will hinder the etching process. So you take this paper part off, and then you remove that copper clad board.
This copper clad board is from where?
Digi-key.
Digi-key? Okay.
Alright, so you have the copper clad board out from its packaging, and then you set it on a flat surface, and then you carefully dimension the circuit so that you have a line where you want to cut out this board, because usually you don't use all of this big board.
Do we have a means to cut it?
For smaller purposes, you use a hacksaw.
Hacksaw.
Yeah. So you set
That's how you did it last time and it worked well? Okay.
So you set the line that you want to cut outside of the working edge so that you have an empty gap here, and you ensure that the line is pretty much parallel with the edge of the table. Then you put a piece of paper, not the glossy paper, but just a piece of paper out here, such that if you make horizontal stroke accidentally with the hacksaw, you don't damage the copper surface. And then you proceed to hacksaw it.
Clamp it down.
Yeah.
We got some clamps?
In the workshop.
Workshop clamps, so you just use standard C clamps?
Yeah.
Okay.
One of the small ones. And you hacksaw. And you repeat that for the other dimension if necessary, and you've got the board with the dimensions that you want. So then...
The other way is to use a paper cutter. Does that work?
I don't know. I've never done that.
Okay. That's probably... Yeah, we could probably... But hacksaw we know works, okay?
Okay. And then, now that the board is cut out to dimension, you set it aside on the working surface, and you have to make the circuit, the etching circuit, and print it out from a laser printer with the etching circuit being upside down, such that you can take the toner, which is on the glossy paper, and because you're going to be doing that, you see the circuit has to be in reverse. So
and what you're printing it on is, what are you printing on?
You're printing on...
It's called...
Laser glossy paper.
Laser glossy paper. What was this about photographic paper?
It's just a glossy
presentation
paper.
Yeah, glossy paper.
Ah,
made for laser.
Okay. Laser glossy photo paper, 32-pound weight, 8.5 by 11 standard for a regular printer. We'll get the printer going. Uh huh. Okay.
This is an example of a glossy paper sheet, right?
Paper example. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
So on the computer, essentially, we want to... one example of a workable toolpath is use MS Paint and make the etching circuit reverse schematic, and then you take that and put it onto GIMP image editor and edit it such that the resolution is proper, because evidently MS Paint, when you print it, if you try to print off that, the scaling is not correct. You get a larger circuit than what is actually supposed to be represented on the software board. So you edit the picture, you edit the schematic on GIMP, then you save the file, then you open that schematic file using just a Windows Photo Viewer, then go to File, Print, and from Windows Photo Viewer you just print and get the options, print again, and it'll come out of your laser printer.
Why don't we just print it from GIMP?
I've never done it.
You've never done it? So, this is based on what he's worked with. So,
okay.
That is possible from GIMP? Okay.
So okay.
That's a cut in the time.
Okay.
Okay, so after you've got the circuit ink on the glossy paper, you have to cut it to glossy paper similarly as you do clipboard, except now you could just use scissors. So, now you, by the lines that you can see on the circuit, you just cut using scissors. And you've got the matching dimension glossy paper with the ink for the board. Okay, so now you set the board with the focus on the working surface. Then you set. Then you take the glossy paper that has the ink on it, and if this is the paper, actually this is the paper, and you have the ink on this side, then you take that and you lie it over the copper board such that the dimension is like the dimension correlation at the external perimeter is like near perfect. Then you take small pieces of tape and tape, say, the middle of two or three sides, like say, here,
just standard
here, just to clamp it down so that doesn't so that the paper doesn't budge.
Yep.
Then you take this iron, plug it into a wall outlet, right? Then you let it lie on the board and wait a few minutes. And then what James Wise does is he takes the tip and kind of goes over it like that. Like that. And then even circles, circling motion. So like a pattern of motion with the tip that has a more focused, more contact between the glossy paper and the...
Is that pretty easy to do from your experience?
Yeah, it's just... I probably overdo it because I don't really know. You know, there's really no feedback to know that you're done. You know, because it's... Cause you,
yeah. Can you burn through too much? Like, can you actually burn it?
I don't think you can do too much.
Uh-huh. And what setting on iron do you do? Do you do just high? Or?
Yeah, just high as it'll go and...
Don't. High as it will go, and that's not going to melt the board or anything, or the paper. Like, I mean, you'd probably want to stop if the actual paper is starting to get brown, right?
Yeah, or just, you know, turn it down a little bit.
Yeah, turn it down. Okay, yeah.
Okay, so if all went well, then the toner from the glossy paper should have been transferred completely onto the copper board, but the glossy paper will still be sticking now to the copper board through the toner. As a kind of adhesive. So you have this copper board, glossy paper combination that you can hold preferably like on its corners. What you want to do is run this over a sink, running water, such that the paper gets wet, and after that, because the paper got soggy, you can just scrape it off with your finger. And it's important that you get all the glossy paper off, otherwise during the etching process, particles or small pieces of the glossy paper will stop the etching from happening at certain instances. That's not good for a finished board because you might get unwanted connections or unwanted lack of connections.
Yeah.
So after the glossy paper is completely removed, after making it soggy, then you have a board with toner on it. That it correlates to the amount of material you want left after the copper is removed. A copper board with ink, basically. And then you set this aside and you begin to prepare the etching container.
Mm-hmm.
So this is glass, and you can use larger container for larger boards if necessary. And this is PCB etching solution, and it contains ferric chloride, ferrous chloride, and hydrochloric acid. So this is a push and twist cap. So you push and twist it, you open it, then you pour about quarter inch, and you'll get a nice layer.
And if you don't have that solution, you can somehow make hydrochloric acid. I don't know how to do that, but ferrous chloride, how about some iron and salt and some kind of a chemical reaction, you might get ferrous chloride. Okay.
Yeah.
Anyways, that's to open source later.
Mm-hmm. And there are also other alternatives. You guys told me he heard of
it's etching.
Like hydrogen peroxide or
things. Yeah. So that'll be some alternative.
So you pour it in for inch of...
Just a warning, I'm going to take 10-minute clips. This is at 9 minutes, so give me like about 30 seconds more, and I'm going to wrap this clip up.
Okay, so then you take the board with the ink on it, and with the ink face up, you take it with pliers, and you dunk it in.
Mm-hmm.
Not also, as a safety note, like you always should be wearing glasses throughout this entire process.
And leave it how long?
Agitate it for 3 minutes, but agitating it like time to time.
Mm-hmm. And then we've got up to the step of having the actual circuit paths on a piece of copper clad board. Okay, that's step one.